planet, and even the Neelachala Dham. Near Neelachala Dham, there's a place where many of you might have gone, the Alarnath. That area is known as Brahmagiri. For the Brahma, he descended. It's a very beautiful place to observe, perform tapasya. So very happily he started his tapasya. Austerities to please Lakshmi Narayan, who were there in Neelachala Dham. So that they will give their darshan. Everybody can take direct darshan of the Lord Supreme Personality of Godhead and thus go back to Godhead. That was the purpose of Brahma. Then when he started observing, performing the severe austerities, this news spread all over the universe. So everybody came to know that a very special thing is going to happen. Now Brahma is performing tapasya. Now Lakshmi Narayan will give darshan to everybody, and having their darshan, all the living entities will go back to Godhead. So everybody very happy. Oh, such a nice thing will happen. But one person was not happy. That is Yamaraj. Yamaraj got very worried. Wow, what is this? Everybody will go back to Godhead, then what shall I do here? How my company will run? All my employers, what they will do? This is how Skandaprana explains. He got very worried that everybody will go back to Godhead. Then immediately he ran from Yamalaka all the way to Neelachala Dham. Then he saw Lakshmi Narayan sitting on the Ratna Singhasan. He immediately started to offer obeisances and all kinds of stava, stuti, praises, prayers to Lakshmi Narayan. And Lord is very happy whenever he listens somebody praising, offering prayers. Both Lakshmi Narayan is next to us, very blissful. Oh my dear son, what do you want? We are very happy with you, we want to fulfill your desire. And Yamaraj said, first you promise, whatever I ask, you will do that. Then they said, yes, whatever you want, I will do it. They're so pleased with Yamaraj. Then Yamaraj said, that, oh my Lord, I heard the Brahma is doing tapasya here to please you so that you will give your darshan, everybody will go back to Godhead. So if everybody will go back to Godhead, what shall I do here? I will have no service for you. So I request you please don't give your darshan, so nobody can go back to Godhead. Then Narayan looking to Lakshmi Devi, so what to do now? Then Lakshmi Devi gave a solution. Okay, they called both Yamaraj and Brahma. So you have to fulfill the desire of both of you. Okay, to fulfill your desire, Yamaraj, so now we will hide ourselves under the golden sand. But as you know, at some time, and one of our great devotees will come here, Indradimna. And even if we are very powerful, we are very good, very hidden subject matter, nobody can find us. But when some devotee come, we become so powerless that we cannot restrict ourselves to hide. We have to reveal. So that time, we will reveal in Chaturdha Murti, Chaturdha in four different forms, Jagannath, Baladev, Subhadra, and Sudarshan Chakra. So in this form, Lord will manifest. So this blessing was given. Then he said, Brahma, you will come and you will install these deities. And whoever will take darshan of these deities, does not matter how much sinful activities they have committed, they will definitely go back to Godhead. Not only whatever sinful activities they have committed, they will become free from the reaction. After taking my darshan, whatever sinful activity they will commit in future, that also they will not get result. But that doesn't mean you will take advantage of this. Oh, very good, just go to Jagannath, take darshan and do commit sinful activities. No, we should not do that. So Brahma is very happy. In due course of time, you know, the other part of the pastimes, how Jagannath Baladeva Subhadra appeared in scripture, it has been explained. The whole Brahma's lifespan is known as para. There are parardha, pratham parardha, first parardha and second parardha. The 50 years of Brahma's lifespan is known as pratham parardha or first parardha. In this parardha, first parardha, Lord, he manifests himself in Neelachala Dham as Nilamadhava. Nilamadhava form. And second parartha, he manifests himself in this Chaturdha Murti. So this story just came to my mind when I heard this translation, when Brahma praying for creative energy, where he is explaining that how living entities are suffering in this material world. So now we'll discuss about the subject matter, today's verse. Brahma explaining through the today's verse that people are suffering so much. So what is the suffering in this material world? What is the real suffering of this material world? Brahma has explained here in this verse, yesterday's verse, hunger, thirst, severe cold, then coughing winter, blasting summer. Then today's verse is saying the material miseries are without factual existence for the soul. As for the soul, there is no misery, there is no suffering. This material world, what we saw, this is good, that is bad. Ei bhala, ei manda, ei sab bhram. This arises from avidya, from ignorance. As all of you might have, you know, that there are five kinds of regions of sufferings: avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, and abhinivesha. And avidya means asatyare satyakare mane. What is not real, we think that is real. Anatma, atma manyate. What is not atma, I think I am self. And what is not suffering, I think this suffering. And what is the suffering and enjoyment in this material world? There is nothing, something definite, that is suffering. What is suffering for you is enjoyment for me. It's like I give sometimes example, what food the Americans they like, we Indians we do not like. Just like a pig, if you give a human being a plate full of fresh stool, he will not like that. But you give a pig, so nice. He'll enjoy out of that. He's enjoying. Is the stool cause of suffering or enjoyment? What is the cause of suffering and enjoyment? Stool is cause of suffering or enjoyment? No. That his food is enjoying. What American likes, the Indians we don't like. When first time 81, I went with my Guru Maharaj on a world tour. And for 5 days, I could not eat anything. At that time, I was not habituated of eating American foods. I was practically starving. And when, even if in India also, what North Indian likes, South Indian they don't like. What the Bengali likes, Hindustani they don't like. No, when Bengali devotees, they go to South India for Rath Yatra or something, then they cry, oh Maharaj, everything is tamarind, sour and sour. They don't like sour foods. Then South Indian will come here, oh Maharaj, everything potato and potato. They don't like potato. So what is the source of our enjoyment? What is suffering? What is this? All different. What is good for me is not good for you. Just like Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Thakur Prabhupada, he had one Gaudiya Math in Burma, Rangoon, Burma. And this Gaudiya Math, some festivities day, they make big feast and they fry puri, luchi puri with pure ghee. And that pure ghee, nice smell. When the smell goes to nearby people, then they come with stick. Hey, what you sadhus are cooking? So bad smell, we cannot tolerate this. They cannot tolerate this sweet smell of ghee. That is unbearable for them. But what is good smell for them, you know? In Rangoon that time, every village, they would have a very big big stone pot, no? And throughout the year, around that village, whatever dog, cat, jackals, they will die. They will bring all the dead bodies of all these animals and they will gather in that pot, the stone pot. Then at the end of the year, it's all rotten, all juice coming from their body. And the whole village has... Many devotees are making their face like this. But you may make your face like this, but for them, nice smell. They'll come with their pot and very equally it has to be shared, you know. Equally it has to be shared, more or less. And they inject that smell. From this you can understand what is enjoyment in this material world. Differs. Because this enjoyment is not the enjoyment, the spiritual, this enjoyment which derives due to the influence of three modes of material nature. So for Sattvaguna people, one enjoyment is different than the enjoyment of Rajaguna people. Rajaguna people's enjoyment is different than the enjoyment of Tamaguna people. So what is the enjoyment and what is the suffering in this material world? We are saying suffering. Janma, mrityu, jara, vyadhi, dukkha, dosha, anudarshanam. Krishna has told also the four kinds of misery. And adhyatmik, adhibhautik, adhidaivik kleshas are there also. But here Brahma is saying, the material miseries are all that factual existence for the soul. So what are the real miseries? The acharyas have analyzed the real misery of the spirit soul, the real suffering of the spirit soul. The real suffering of the spirit soul is not birth, death, old age and disease. That's it. The goal of our life is not to get out of this material world. That is not the goal of our life. To become free from material existence is not the goal of our life. Because the sufferings of the living entity is not birth, death, old age and diseases. They are not the real suffering. There are another suffering that which we do not know, we do not understand because of ignorance, avidya. So what is that suffering? That suffering is Krishna nabhajana dukkha kahiva kahare. That we are not serving Krishna. That suffering, just like we say the ananda, there is material ananda, jadananda, there is brahmananda, there is premananda, there is sevananda, the different kinds of ananda. End of my class I will explain in more detail. Now I will say only about brahmananda. What is this brahmananda? Brahmananda means the absence of suffering. There is no external ananda you get there, bliss, no. In material world, we are suffering. Jadananda. Jadananda means the reduction of suffering. Under Brahmananda means the absence of suffering. In the same way, what is the enjoyment? That what is the enjoyment you are lacking? Or what is the real suffering in this material world? The real suffering is that we are deprived of enjoying by serving Krishna. That is suffering. That has to be realized. Ordinary people can't realize. There is unbearable suffering for the spirit soul. Adhyatmik, adhibhautik, adhidaivik klesa, janma mrityu jara vyadhi is external, as Brahma is saying here, or that factual existence. But what is the real suffering? The real suffering that we are deprived of that enjoyment, we are deprived of that pleasure which we would derive by serving Krishna. That is the real suffering that one has to recognize. And by avidya one can't recognize. Parabidya, by parabidya, real intelligence gives this knowledge that we are really suffering. Otherwise, people are suffering. Here it has been explained, people are suffering so much. But if you are suffering so much, then why don't we try to get out of this place? Because you do not recognize our suffering. Because you do not understand what is the real suffering of being deprived of that enjoyment of serving Krishna. That has not been realized. That's why living entities, they do not want to go back to Godhead. As scripture explains, what makes us to stay in this material world in spite of so much suffering? As our acharyas have explained, Krishna has his internal potency and is Bahiranga external energy. The external energy has two components. One is Prakshepatmika Shakti, another is Avaranatmika Shakti. That makes us to come to this material existence. That is business of Prakshepatmika Shakti. Then when you come to this material world, so much suffering, then immediately we would like to go back to Godhead. But that does not happen. Why does not happen? Because Avaranatmika Shakti. There's another energy which covers our intelligence, which does not give us chance to understand that we are suffering. As a result, the pig eating stool says, oh, I am enjoying so much eating stool because of this avaranatmika shakti. And we are subject to such a position, situation now, very difficult for us to give up this material facilities. Just like Like there's one man, he was very hungry, feeling very hungry. For a long time he has not eaten anything. Then he was walking, then he came to temple. So in that temple there are many pillars. And this man is feeling a lot of stomach pain, no? Because of hunger, feeling pain. So to become free from this pain, so he went to a pillar. And he pressed his belly into the pillar and holding like this to the pillar. So he pressed his belly into the pillar, he got really relief. His pain is relieved. But actually pain is not relief, pain is there because of pressing, so pain is relieved. So he's standing holding the pillar like this. Then after some time, one lady came out of the temple with some prasad. And this man is asking, holding like this, please give me some prasad. This lady is saying, okay, I'm ready to give you. So please take, but you have to take out your hand. No? If you hold like this, if I give you, how can you eat? There's a pillar between you and this. And if you take, after I put the food, if you take your hand out, then everything will fall down. Please, take your hand out and take this food. So no, you give me here. Because the temporary relief he's getting by pressing his belly, he's thinking if I free myself, I'll get pain. No? So he's not trying to take out that. So as a result, our situation is like this. We're getting a temporary relief, so we don't have to give up this material facilities to get the spiritual things. No, we are free from problems because we are pressing our belly into this pillar. So that is the facility of this material world. And there's so much attached to that. I can't give up this facility. Even the higher facility is there. I'll keep my belly pressed to pillar, same time you give me the food here also. Then how can we enjoy? So this is what put us in this material world in very, very uncomfortable situation. So now Brahma explaining. In this verse, that material misery is over the factual existence. There is no misery at all, the real misery that we are suffering because of lack of the enjoyment of rendering devotional service unto Krishna. So why at all we gave up the devotional service unto Krishna? That is because of our enviousness. In this material world, everybody envious. You know why you are envious? Because originally you are envious to Krishna. Originally you are envious to Krishna. Prabhupada explaining in Srimad Bhagavatam Mahanavaj Parpat that there are many beautiful ladies on this earthly planet, this world. The most beautiful lady, if you take a most beautiful lady, what they call the most beautiful lady? This earth, this world? Miss World. They call Miss World. Some days Miss Universe. I don't know why they say Miss Universe. No, maybe okay, you are a beautiful lady in this world. Miss World is okay. And Prabhupada said, you take this Miss World, the most beautiful lady, and you compare with the beautiful ladies of the denizens of the heavenly planet, the most beautiful lady of earth planet will look like a frog. Like a frog. You compare the beauty of the heavenly planets, the beauty of a frog. Then Prabhupada is saying, but the ladies, the Lakshmis of Vaikuntha, they are much more beautiful. The denizens of the heavenly planets, much more beautiful. Just imagine how beautiful we are. But the gopis of Goloka Vrindavan, they are millions of times more beautiful than the Lakshmis. Just try to imagine how beautiful they would be. And if such one gopi, beautiful lady will come to this earthly planet, what will happen to the people? Everyone will get felt, no? They will felt this is beauty. They will digest it. And Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj, in Jolene's Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj was telling, and there are millions of such beautiful girls are there in Golok Vrindavan. There's only one boy. All these millions of beautiful girls, they're simply watching his face like this. Oh, they're blinking their eyes. And Maharaj was telling, just see, who can afford not to become envious of Krishna? How can we resist? How can we resist not to be envious? Huh? Oh, he's only enjoying that in this material world. If somebody becomes get a beautiful wife, nice building, money, we are burning. Oh, he's becoming so rich. I cannot become rich. We are burning and envious so much. And just see the opulence of Krishna. And that means then when I heard that, I used to be very serious. Oh, that much resistant we have to be. For this enviousness, that means we have to make really Krishna is mine. Then only you can become free of enviousness. Just like Brajavasi is that Krishna is mine. So they are free of enviousness. So in this way, this enviousness actually in this material world. When we left spiritual world, we came to this material world. What is the source of our enjoyment? The enviousness is the source of our enjoyment here. In this material world, actually we do not enjoy by how much I get. I don't enjoy by how much I get. That is not the source of my enjoyment. My enjoyment is how much less you get than me. That where I enjoy. It doesn't matter. I am getting 1 crore rupees. I am not happy. If you are getting 1 crore 10 lakhs rupees, I am not happy. But I am getting 100 rupees. If you get 90 rupees, I am happy with that. No problem. It's true. If you analyze really, the happiness does not arise, even if the people say, oh, materially happy, material opulence does not give you happiness. You may accumulate so much material opulence, but somebody you see has more than this, then he's simply suffering. Doesn't matter how much material opulence you have. Just like one story I say. So there is one tantric, one sadhak. The sadhak went to forest. He was doing betal sadhana. And there he got siddhi. So the betal, that ghost or whatever is doing sadhana, he arrived in front of him. I am very pleased with you. What do you want? What should I do for you? Then he said, you please bless me. That whatever I think, whatever I meditate, immediately I will get that. Then this betal said, tathastu, let it happen. But whatever you get, your neighbor will get double than you. But this person was so much in ecstasy, he did not hear that next sentence. He was very happy to listen to the first sentence. So next sentence he did not hear much. He's from a village, poor village guy. So he went back to his village. You see, in India, the villagers, the goal of every grihasthas, that what should I do in my life? The first thing is I should build a nice house for me. Now, this is the villagers always think, if I can build a house, then my human life is successful. I have done so much, I build a house. So this man, he went to his village, and the village, everybody has straw house. The first thing he went inside, and he's meditating, let me have one two-story building. So as soon as he thought this, immediately he has two-story building. And he was happy. But happy to some extent. Another source of happiness is not how much you get. You get until unless others see your opulence, you don't derive any pleasure out of that. For example, the ladies, they'll decorate their body nicely, put ornaments, nice sari, and sit inside the house. Will they become happy? No. They'll go out to see her. Or anything, even if we buy a car. You buy a car or a house. I remember during my childhood times, there is Durga Puja, Saraswati Puja, we have a new pant shirt, no? Shasana ji put a new pant shirt, immediately we go out, just see how nice pant shirt I have. Then the real pleasure comes, right? If you get others that don't see, you don't get the pleasure out of that. When others see, you compare. As not only others see and become envious of you, then you become happy. When others see your opulence, you know they are burning. But let him burn. I am opulence. I am very happy with that. This is the subtle nature of material enjoyment. Subtle nature of material enjoyment. So this man, to become really happy, then immediately he is thinking, oh, everybody they have straw house. Now I have two-story building. So everybody's straw house, they have a two-story building, it's very big, great matter. You'll become happy. Somebody in Manhattan, New York has a two-story building. What happiness will derive out of that? The big, big buildings are there. You'll not be happy. But a small village, two-story building, very big deal. She immediately came out of the house to show the villagers, see, I have two-story building so that he'll become more happy. But he was very surprised to see his neighbor has four-story building. So how to speak of becoming happy, he's burning. Wow, he has four-story building. Then immediately he went inside. He can meditating. Let me have also four-story building. Then he got four-story building. The neighbor got eight-story building. So in this again and again he's going. And he's meditating for more and more opulence. But more and more opulence he gets and more suffering for him. Because he's burning because neighbor getting double than him. So he's very unhappy. So what to do, what to do? So one day he got a good idea. So then that day he went inside the house and he's meditating. Let one of my eye become blind. So one of his eye become blind. Then he came out of the house, his neighbor both eyes blind. Then he was very happy. Ah, now something I got. It does not matter. His one eye got blind. Neighbor two eyes blind. So he's very happy. Actually, if we analyze our happiness, it arises from this concept. Just see, what a horrible source of our enjoyment in this material world. Always we see when somebody growing, somebody developing, our heart burns. You'll realize it more better when you try for it. When you try not to become envious, the difficulty will understand, more difficulties. Very difficult not to become envious. Just see how important it is, how important. And when we see the Lord is enjoying us, millions of beautiful ladies walking, watching on Him, it will be very, very difficult for us. So that's what Brahma is explaining here, in his prayers, that what is the real enjoyment? The real enjoyment we derive by serving the Supreme Personality of Godhead, by engaging in the devotional service unto the lotus feet of Krishna. So what is that ananda? I'll just analyze a little bit, 5 minutes, though it is 9 o'clock already, 5 minutes to analyze. If this is the suffering, or there is material suffering, and there is temporary suffering, a suffering due to ignorance, there is enjoyment, bodily comfort, mental peace, spiritual bliss. There are so many kinds of explanations are there. People generally, they go try to get ananda. But there are different kinds of things. They are like body does not get ananda, body gets some comfort. And mind doesn't get ananda, mind gets some peace, which is mental peace, bodily comfort, but spiritual bliss. The bliss relates to the spirit soul. Bliss doesn't relate to this body. Bliss doesn't relate to mind. Bliss relate to the spirit soul. Body become happy. The material ananda, jadananda, not a jadananda, the ananda we derive from a life of a hog, all the up to the life of Brahmaloka, all this jadananda. And Prabhupada saying, what is this ananda? This is not the ananda, this is reduction of sufferings. That in ancient times, the kings would take the criminals and they would make him to drown in the water in the lake. Then he will feel very suffocated. And he will become very suffocated, they will pull him out. Little relief. And this is material ananda. Little relief from suffering, early reduction of suffering. That we think ananda, but this is not real ananda. By this karma, the ananda is not real ananda. But jnanis, they have understood. There is suffering, this material world is full of suffering. Then they strive for something else to become free from this material suffering. Then they go merge into Brahma Jyoti, where they get Brahmananda. Brahmananda is higher than this Jadananda. But what is this Brahmananda? The Brahmananda is simply the absence of material sufferings. So there is somebody pinching you. You are getting pain, release, you become free from pain. But somebody put sandalwood palm, wow, nice feeling. That is something extra. So higher than Brahmananda is Premananda. When one develops that love, Premananda, so that's what we say, the goal of our life, what is the goal of our life? The goal of our life is to get Krishna Prema. Lot of enjoyment, lot of bliss there in that Krishna Prema. But when before I come to know the subject matter, then I used to think myself, but anyway, we have a goal, we have a purpose, we have an agenda of serving Krishna. That we want Krishna Prem because Krishna Prem gives so much bliss. So how this is causeless bhakti? Then one day I came across subject matter explained in Chaitanya Charitamrita. How it is explaining that the pure devotees, even if they don't want the Premananda, so where it has been explained when the devotees Krishna there, and the gopis they are serving, they are fanning Krishna, they are serving Krishna. The symptom of Krishna Prema, the tears will come from their eyes, and gopis are thinking if tears will come from our eyes, our face will become ugly, then how Krishna will enjoy? Then gopis are saying, oh Krishna Prem, you stay, you wait for some time. Don't disturb me in my service. I have to seva to Krishna. Devotees, they are fanning Krishna. If tears come, they cannot see Krishna. They say, oh Krishna Prem, you stay, you wait for some time. Don't disturb in our seva. So that's why there is something more higher than Premananda. That is known as Sevananda. By rendering devotional service unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, so much bliss. The service mood, so much bliss there. Except the devotees, no karmi, no jnani, no yogi can understand. By serving Krishna, how much one can enjoy? But everything he can reject. This Sevananda gives so much pleasure. But materialistic people, as soon as we tell, you surrender to Krishna. No. Surrendering? I will not surrender. Why they don't want to surrender? Why we do not want to surrender? Because we know surrender means suffering. If you become somebody's servant, then we will be exploited. That is what in this material world, servants are always exploited. So we are scared to be servant. But in spiritual world, it's completely different. The unique nature of spiritual world is, one can become independent by surrendering. It's very contradictory sentence. By surrendering, how you can become independent? By surrendering means you're losing your independence. But the beauty of spiritual world is, by surrendering, one will become independent. When you surrender to Krishna, it's not necessary you have to be scared, oh, I will surrender to Krishna, I'll lose all my independence, no. Because when you surrender to Krishna, by surrendering to Krishna, by becoming pure devotee of Krishna, Krishna is saying that my devotees, I become controlled by my devotees. This unique nature is there. I become arrested within the heart of my devotees. So that happens in spiritual world when you serve Krishna, when you surrender to Krishna. Then Krishna is become sold out to us by the love. Aham bhakta paradhinai asvatantra ibadija sadhvigrastarideya bhaktir bhakta janapriya. This is the beauty, attractive part of this Krishna consciousness philosophy. So that's why we don't have to become envious of Krishna. We don't have to become scared that I lose my independence. The other is so beauty. That's so beautiful. That Krishna is saying that aham bhakta paradhinai asvatantra ibadija. O Dijas, O Brahmanas, all the Vedic literatures, they proclaim that I am the independent Swarat Purusha. But I am not Swarat, Aham Bhakta Paradhin, I am Paratantra. I am not Swatantra, Aham Bhakta Paratantra, Aham Bhakta Paradhani, Aswatantra Vedija, Sadhvigrastaritya Bhaktari Bhakta Janakriya. Just see the beauty of the spiritual world. By surrendering, by becoming servant of Krishna, that Krishna becomes controlled by his servants. And the service mood is so great. What to speak of the living entities by service mood will become happy. Even if Krishna himself also wants to become servant. One thing I realize, sometimes I think, in this material world, everybody think, we become great, we become big, then we will become happy. That is because everybody wants to contest with, compete with God. God is great, So I become great, I'll become equal to God, or one to God, I'll remove God, I'll take his position, I can become the great, I'll become happy. Everybody thinks that to become God, one has to be great, very great. But God is very clever. So actually, to become God, the absolute Param Brahma, the criteria of Param Brahma is not his great. He is greater than the greatest and smaller than the smallest also. Anur Anyan Mahat Mahiyan. So all you are trying, how I will become master, I will become greater than the greatest. But none of us are trying how to become smaller than the smallest. In this way, God has tricked us. Oh, you want to become equal with me? Okay, all try to compete with me, become greater than the greatest. So all trying to become greater than the greatest. But nobody trying to be smaller than the smallest. So in this way, the Lord has hidden the secret from us. So he is God because not only he is greater than the greatest, but he can become the smaller than the smallest. So this secret matter been taught to devotees, not to karmis, not to jnanis, not to yogis. The devotees they have been taught this trick. How if you surrender, by surrendering, one can become the greater than the greatest. The very unique relationship between the devotee and the Supreme Personality of Godhead, where the master wants to serve the servant. In material world you never see. The master wants to serve the servant. The spiritual world, Krishna wants to serve his servant. So in this unique relationship, we can establish only by rendering devotional service unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So I will not take more time because I have already passed 10 minutes. Thank you so much for giving your attention. I'm very, very grateful because of the presence of great personalities like Radhanath Maharaj, Ambarish Prabhu, Bhavand Prabhu. By their blessings, I could speak few words in front of all this great assembly of the devotees. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.